can you have everyone's attention, please? I think we might be having a microphone at some point, but not yet. For people that don't know me, my name is Jonathan Pryor. I'm one of the local councillors for Headingley and Hyde Park. So I'd like to welcome you to Broodmell. So as well as being a councillor here, I'm also deputy executive member for Children and Families on the council. And we've seen the impact of the horrific Tory cuts onto our council and what it's doing to our children's services. People often think of Leeds as a really Labour city, but actually in 2010, we were still being run by a Tory and Lib Dem coalition. We had one in Leeds before it was famous worldwide. And they absolutely decimated our children's services. And that was at a time when local councils were properly funded. Now in the time of cuts here in Leeds, we've really managed to buck the trend nationally. We inherited the children's services, which was rated inadequate by Ofsted, and now it's rated good. And we're the only core city that's rated good by Ofsted. So we're doing well, we're bucking the trend, but the Tory cuts on schools are still horrific. We're not allowed to open new schools, and yet we've got more kids without school places. So they're not just cutting the money, they're changing the rules and making it horrific for us. So today, I've got a few speakers for you. So following me will be Councillor Lisa Mulheron. Now she's my boss, and the executive member for Children and Families. Lisa's on the front line, day in, day out, fighting for our children against these Tory cuts. After Lisa, we've got Rachel Reeves, the MP for neighbouring Leeds West. I'm sure everyone will have seen on Facebook Rachel's fantastic takedown of the Carillion bosses. Then after Rachel, we have our fantastic Shadow Education Secretary, Angela Rayner, who's... happy there's another ginger cat lover in politics. So. then after Angela's spoken, there'll be some time for questions for Angela. And then finally, we've got our fantastic candidate in Kirkstall, Hannah Bithell. So if anyone lives over the other side of the train tracks, it's so important to vote for Hannah. We need three Labour councillors in Kirkstall. We need three Labour councillors here in Headingley. If we don't have a Labour council after May, you know, I dread to think what some ragtag coalition of the Tories and Lib Dems will do to our council and our children's services. So, without further ado, I'll introduce Lisa. Thank you.
Can you hear me okay without microphones? I've just seen one put down here. He's a great deputy and he's helping me out a lot with the work that we're trying to do here in Leeds. As Jonathan said, we have a city, a bit of a two different cities really. We have a huge inequality gap between our best off and worst off parts of Leeds. There are 37,000 children in Leeds living in poverty, and we know the difference that makes to their lives, their potential and their future prospects. Something that we here in this city want to be making a huge difference for. So we've been doing a lot of work on that. We've kept our investment in children's centres. Every single children's centre in Leeds has stayed open. And that's in the face of hundreds of them closing up and down the country because of the government's cuts to local authorities. We've kept ours open because we know that we want to give every single child in Leeds the best start in life. And by doing that, working with vulnerable families, those in the most difficult circumstances, from before birth through to the age of five, we can ensure those kids get that gap closed before they start school. We know that if you don't actually do that work between naught and two in particular, the gap widens and never fully closes. So we've kept our children's centres open here. We've also kept school improvement services in Leeds. Again, something that most local authorities in the country have given up on because they simply cannot afford to keep them going. And we've also done that to keep our schools within our local authority control. We have lots of schools still working with us in Leeds. The vast majority of our primary schools are still state schools, and about half of our secondary schools. Now, clearly, we want to keep more of our resources within public control. We also want to be working with those schools to be giving young people the best possible start and to give them the best education. We've got most of those schools are good and outstanding in Leeds, and we know that that's partly through the work that we've been doing with schools to help them to improve standards, to tackle the inequalities that they face and the challenges that families in Leeds, across Leeds, are struggling with as a result of austerity and government funding cuts. So while we're doing all of that work, we've been hit time and time again by government funding cuts. 43% of Leeds City Council's budget has been slashed through government funding cuts. We've lost £43 million in children's services alone. So whilst we're trying our hardest to make that difference for people here in Leeds, we are doing it in the face of austerity, not only in the communities that our children are growing up in, but also the government cuts directly to the services that we use to support people, to give them a hand up. So I want to just say it's brilliant to have Angela here. We need to have more powers back to local authorities to be able to support young people to get our schools back where they need to be. We don't have the powers, as Jonathan's already said, to build new schools. We've got all the responsibility for delivering school places, but we can't actually open a school. So we're having to work with a range of unaccountable government agencies who underfund those school places and who have the powers to decide who will run them. So we have to have free school bids, and we have academies that come in to run schools that we have the responsibility to open and to find places. So for me, the sooner we can get back to having a Labour government who wants to invest in services. Services that we use to provide and support children and families is the way forward. Then you can actually hold people to account, and we can work with you to make sure that the right standards are there and the right support is there to close that inequality gap. Thank you.
Well, first of all, can I thank so many of you for coming out today to hear Angela speak about Labour's education policy. And it's great to be here in Leeds North West, in Labour Leeds North West, where Alex and whenever the next election comes, we've got to do everything we can to ensure that Alex stays as the MP here, but also that we have Labour MPs in Pudsey, in Morley and Outwood, and in Aylmer and Rothwell too. And if we do that, we will have a Labour government with Jeremy Corbyn as Prime Minister. Yay! Were born just months after Margaret Thatcher became Prime Minister. And the whole time that we were at school was under Conservative governments. And we saw the damage that they did, and many of you will remember and would have experienced firsthand the damage they did. The fragmentation and the privatisation of our education system, the huge numbers of young people who left school and college without jobs to go to, and the youth training schemes that condemn many of them to poverty and to misery. The last Labour government did a huge amount to tackle that, most of all with the creation of Sure Start centres and the investment in our education. But what we're seeing today, after 7.5 years, almost 8 years of Conservative government, is more fragmentation, more privatisation, more cuts to those essential services that, as Lisa said, are so important for reducing the inequalities that we see in our society. And it makes my heart break when I go into some of the schools in my constituency and knowing how much more they could do if they had the resources, the teachers, the teaching assistants, and the support they need to give every child the best possible start in life. And that's why I'm so proud that Angela is our spokesperson for education. Because Angela, more than anybody, is putting those issues front and centre stage. Whether it's our policies to get rid of the university tuition fees, to make school meals free for all children, or to invest in those children's centres that Angela has spoken about passionately, about what a difference they've made to her life. So I just also just thank the people who have made today possible. Most of all, Kate Earle, who is somewhere in Kate.
Raffle ticket.
team locally and across the whole of Leeds. Thanks, Kate, for getting Angela here and getting everybody here today. Well done, Kate. Big round of applause. Social Club for hosting us today. It's a great venue. I'm sure many of you have been here many times before, but we're not going to get any better speaker or performance than we will from Angela today. So I'll hand over now to Angela.
Thank you, and I've got to say thanks to Kate as well, because I've never had a welcoming present like the one that Kate gave me today, with a basket with all these goodies in it that I'm going to take back, and Jeremy's going to be well jealous when I get back later this afternoon. I've got to say, this venue's pretty cool as well, and the amount of people standing room only is amazing. Last year I played Wembley. Never did I think I would ever say in my career I played Wembley, but I appeared at Wembley Stadium. I should explain this now, otherwise we'd be all freaked out by it. But I appeared at Wembley Stadium, and I was on stage just after Justin Greening was on to 4,000 teachers that were in the audience, because they had their conference there. And I've got to say, never did a Secretary of State get such a bad welcome, and never did the actual Shadow Secretary of State, the Education Secretary-elect, get such a better welcome. Represent you in Parliament and to hopefully deliver your aspirations and dreams about what our National Education Service will mean, because it is mirrored on the National Health Service, one of our best institutions that Labour created, and it will be free at the point of use from cradle till grave. So we will have an emphasis on making sure that our Sure Start centres, that our early years, that Lisa talks about, those early interventions, that they're at the heart of what a National Education Service is. Because if you try and do it at 10, or even 5, or if you try and do it at higher education or further education or secondary, you failed. It has to start right at the beginning of life, right at those early stages, because otherwise children will always be behind. Not only do we know that because the evidence says it, we know that from our emotional connections. I talk about my background and the fact that my mum was illiterate, my mum couldn't read or write, and I wasn't what they call school ready because of the system and the problems that my mum faced as I was growing up. I became her main carer. I talk about those things, not because I want to talk about myself, but because I want to let other people know that we all have these connections, and many people have shared their experiences with me, and they're not feeling the failures that the system made them feel, you know, whether that's through selection, through grammar schools, or whether, like me, I left school at 16 pregnant with no qualifications. And the system currently makes people feel like failures. It's got worse since the Conservatives came to power. We told half of young people going into secondary school last year, the first opposition outing that I had at the dispatch box was challenging the government on their SATs results, key stage 2 results, where they pushed new proposals through and told half of the children going into secondary school that they failed, that they wasn't at the required amount. And they still, even though they labelled them, they gave no resources to schools and to local authorities to help those children reach a standard that the government had set, even though half of those children were told that they wasn't at the required level. And we've all had moments in our lives where we felt that we weren't good enough. Can you imagine those exciting moments when you think you're going to big school, that feeling of fear and dread, but also anticipation that you're all grown up and going there, and knowing that you've been set up to fail right from the start and told that you're not good enough. It's disgusting, and it's no surprise that in secondary schools now we have high levels of mental health problems. High levels. I got inundated with parents telling me that they've off-rolled their children, that they've taken them. High levels now of homeschooling, because our system does not cater for our young people. It does not support them. And many teachers, we have a recruitment and retention crisis. I actually think the main problem that we have is teachers leaving the profession because they're not allowed to be teachers anymore. whole generation of people, unfortunately, not us, but this Tory dogma government are going to fail them. So our National Education Service is not only going to have to cater for the children that are going through compulsory education when we have the next Labour government, but it's going to have to look after all of our society and bring people in, because I think an education system is not just about a job or a particular time in life. It's the community good. It creates wealth for the community. It raises everybody's aspirations by being able to be part of something. There's lots of people that have to retrain now, or they lose a loved one and they're lonely and they've got different aspects going on in their lives. We need an education service that can bring people in at whatever age. You know, many of my friends, and they had children, and I'm in my 30s now, they dreamed once of becoming a teacher or a nurse or whatever else they wanted to be, but life gets in the way. And then there's arbitrary caps on people's aspirations. We need people in those jobs. We need people with those skills. We need people to have those opportunities as automation comes online so that they can retrain and go into education. And it's not just a socialist thing to do, which is what drives me and drives many of us in the audience, but it's an economic imperative for us to do it. It was before Brexit, even more so. And we're often told that those of us who are in those seats that voted heavily for Brexit are somehow, we don't know what we want. But I think part of the reason that people were so frustrated is they feel like we're managing decline. They feel like their young people don't have opportunities anymore. And partly, they're right. But it was never Europe that was the problem. Europe was part of the solution, not part of the problem, yet people were so angry because they were so disillusioned with what the political parties were offering them. And that brings me to really what I want to say in closing. We are in different times. Jeremy Corbyn, as leader of the Labour Party, has taken us to what we are. No longer do we knock on a door and feel lower than a Jehovah's Witness or someone trying to No longer do we feel like if we could just speak to the head of the house and run away as quickly as possible without someone saying you're all the same, great. We go there proud of who we are. We go there knowing what we stand for. Never has it been more clearer about what the Labour Party stands for. It's about fairness, it's about equality, it's about support, it's about making sure we've got good public services that doesn't let people die outside Westminster, homeless, without support. It's about every single child being given the opportunity to do what they want to do and succeed in life, and telling people that whatever our differences are, we make up a community. We are not all the same, and we should be celebrated for the people we are. We will end the marketisation and privatisation of our education. And we won't do it because I'm ideologically dogma, like Theresa May on grammar schools. We'll do it because the evidence says that the best system for our young people's education is a comprehensive state system. Worldwide, that's what it says. And our next Labour government will not tinker around the edges. No more Magnolia politics, as I like to call it, where we all don't want to upset anyone, but in the process we cheese off everybody because nobody quite knows what we're about. We will have, I mean, that manifesto that we had last year was absolutely tremendous. You owned it. We didn't have time to remake it. We did it on the back of what you have been telling us for years, and we listened to you and we put it into practice. We're now building on that. We're building on the details. We're out for consultation on the charter for the National Education Service, which will talk about local accountability. It will talk about building society, building our industries, not having privatisation in our schools, and we will have a manifesto next time that will build on what we did in 1945, and it will finish the job. Thank you very much.
Angie has asked is we take all the questions that we've got and then she will respond to all of them at once. After this, Angie is going to another event in Headingley with Alex Sobel, so she won't be able to stay right until the end. So we'll take questions now and then we'll hear from Hannah. But whilst we're hearing from Hannah, Angie will have to nip off. So if you've got questions, if you raise your hands and I'll call as many people as we can. When you ask a question, maybe if you just say who you are and where you're from as well, that would be great. Yeah, Gloria there, and then, in fact, there are four people on that row together. Yeah.
Do you want to stand up?
Yeah, yeah, probably easier.
I just want to thank you for your attitude towards animal welfare. And I noticed on Facebook that you were a sort of campaigner for the anti-badger, Stop the Badger Pill, which I was thrilled about. And Kurt Still Labour actually put forward a motion, which I actually put forward, it went through to the Shadow Environment Minister Defra and hopefully Jeremy Corbyn. And I noticed in the paper this week that Labour have said if they get in, they're going to stop the badger pull, which thrilled me. Now, I know that Michael Gove is supposed to be this eco warrior. I don't think so, but anyway, whatever. I saw another post on Twitter with him and Brian May, who's the real big badger campaigner. I just wondered how far it had all got and how near we are from stopping this appalling, horrific, torturous badger pull. Thank you.
Right, the next three, just move along in the line.
Hi, I'm Rachel. Hi, Angela. Yeah. Thanks for coming. I'm a teacher, a high school teacher, and I just wanted to ask a question really about the curriculum, because I know anyone who's a teacher here will know that our curriculum has been narrowed so much that basically that there's a lot of the fun and enjoyment of education has been squeezed out of it, particularly as you get higher up. And I think one of the things that we would like the Labour government to think about is a potential, hopefully, Labour government, is kind of giving more power back to teachers and listening to teachers and giving us the power back to plan the curriculum, because I know we feel that for many years we've kind of been called names and looked down on, and so I think that's something that's really, really important, kind of giving the power back to teachers to plan the curriculum and to make it fun again, which we'd love. Thank you.
Yes, sorry, Laura Jane, Army Branch, National Education Union, and a drama teacher. But one of the things I say is that although I am teaching at the moment in secondary school in West Yorkshire, I'm also desperately looking for a job outside education. And I just wondered how on earth are the Labour government, which I know is coming, how are we going to make teaching a profession that people actually want to do again? Because I'm afraid if I can, I'm on my way out, and it breaks my heart to say that.
I'm from the Quatsi constituency. I'm a teacher too, but I don't teach in England at the moment. But I taught, I was in support for 2 years in inner city schools in Leeds, and so I learned a bit about the education system. My question is, Ofsted and things like that were mentioned earlier on, and some of the things that have been said about the curriculum being very dictated, etc. I found in the years I spent at British school, seeing it from a point of view from somebody outside the British education system, is it's all very regimented. It's all very competitive towards becoming a good school or an outstanding school, etc. There's endless statistics around charts, left, right, and center. Teachers are always assessed, etc. I noticed that in terms, for example, of reading schemes, it seems to be more important to count the number of words the kids read or the quizzes that they do, rather than get children to actually read. But all this is part of a system that's so tight and regimented, and I think that puts teachers off and support staff too. So hopefully there would be a change in that. That's my question.
Thank you. Right, we'll take some questions from this side now. This lady here, the scarf, and is it Sally? And then gentleman just behind, and then gentleman right at the back there. Yeah.
Thank you. My name's Kath Owen. I'm from Chapel Allerton Labour. I'm also a UNISON rep working in a university, so it's really great to see the Secretary of State-elect coming from a UNISA rep background. So it's really just, could you say something about Labour's plans for higher education? We're facing increasing marketisation of our universities and colleges, and that's having a really detrimental impact, not on only on the students, but on the staff. And also, this is a shout out for people to support the UCU lecturer strike, which is... Labour Party banners down there at the picket lines. You can find all the information on the UCU website and Facebook.
Thank you.
Yeah, Sally Kincaid from National Education Union, NUT section and the Wakefield Branch Secretary. Angela, you were a breath of fresh air. Mm-hmm. Having had to deal with CEOs after CEOs of multi-academy trusts who are on £120,000, £160,000, £250,000 a year, telling me what's right for our children, when I know TAs are having to buy glue sticks and kids are being excluded because they don't fit the model of the multi-academy trust. Please tell me that you are going to, because obviously we've had the Wakefield City Academy Trust collapse, 8,500 students, we've got a new map coming in, we know a trust in this area that excludes kids because they've got special needs, and we can talk about that one. I can name the Shaman, because he was in the TS, Gorse Academy, does exactly that, excludes kids with special needs. So will Labour please let the academies come back into the local authority, where we can have proper democratic control, and stop our schools being exam prisons, which is what they are. Yeah.
Yes, two other questions that I've called already, yeah.
Hi Angela, I'm David, I'm from the Elmet and Rothwell constituency. I'm a teacher in secondary school for about 10 years now. I just wanted to know a little bit about Labour's opinion on the English baccalaureate. I think it's similar to what the ladies have spoken about over there, that it's massively narrowed and the subjects available. A lot of my colleagues have either had to go out for consultation for redundancy or they've left the profession because you know, people have lost the possibility to do art subjects, technology subjects. I mean, I've been lucky in the subject that I teach. It's one that the government seems to really like, but it's been very negative for the students who in the past wanted to be there, but we've got a lot of students now who would much prefer to be doing something else. So it's bad for us and it's bad for the students.
Gentlemen at the back, can I just encourage people to try and keep their questions as concise as possible, because I want to get Angela to be able to properly reply to you. So gentlemen at the back.
It's about the testing regime in school and mental health. As a parent of a daughter who dropped out of education after A-levels because of the pressure she was put under, no provision of mental health assistance, and I think the whole testing regime, right from the beginning, right up to, should be scrapped completely.
Yes,
and let's
yes.
give the control in schools back to the people who really count, which is the kids and the teachers. And that would be so easily done. The model in Finland is fantastic. Why are we not letting our kids play up to the age of seven?
Let's move over to the back on this side of the room. So, chat there. Then, guy over there. Yeah, you. then, yes. There with the curly hair, yeah, right. And then, yes, the person who, yes, with the scarf there, the grey scarf.
So
the four of you.
Yep,
okay, go.
Hi, so Richard, Leeds Northwest, and also a UCU member at Leeds University. There were two comments Andrew made, an excellent talk, which I'd really like to hear more about. There was one comment you made about not putting arbitrary caps, I didn't quite get what that was in reference to. And there was another comment you made about retraining people, particularly to deal with the changing world of work, increasing levels of automation, AI, etc. I'd like to hear more about what Labour's position is on that.
Yeah, then.
My name's John Woods, I'm Leeds West CLP, and I'm also a Unite Rep Traffic Council and Unite Union Learning Rep Traffic Council. My question's in regards to the apprenticeship levy. At the moment, the local authorities and public sector as a whole as a target of 2.2% of apprentices by 2020. What that means is for local authorities who are having the budget slashed massively is that those apprenticeships are just for 2 years, and then there's no guarantee of a job at the end of it. What are Labour going to do to make sure that these young people and older people as well who are taking on apprenticeships aren't thrown up in scrap heap after the 2 years of completion of level two or level three?
Hi, Angela. My name is Connor. I've come from York. This is a somewhat wide-scoping question, but given the stuff that was in the manifesto on new forms of public ownership, and especially the co-op stuff, which entails sort of being a participant in the economy, how can we make the education system useful to that in terms of, at the moment, it's basically set up for the 19th century factory system and doesn't encourage citizenship at all? So how do we make it something that children take ownership of rather than just seeing something that's done to them because, oh, well, you just want to go to school?
Thank you.
Hi,
Deborah.
I'm a head teacher of a primary school in the Morley and Outwood constituency. And you talked about mental health in secondary schools, and I think the mental health issues of children as young as five. And we're also dealing with the mental health of their parents. And I think the links, there are very strong links between what's happening in education and the cuts that have been made in social care and mental health, because what's happening is everything is coming back to the schools, and we are dealing with things that we're not trained to deal with, and trying to support these children whilst also dealing with these unobtainable targets that we're having to hit as well. I'd also like to know exactly what that lady said, what's going to happen about the existing multi-academy trusts and how a Labour government will deal with what's already in situation that we have at the moment.
Right, I'm just going to take a last group of questions and then come back to Andrew to respond. So, Al, the two ladies sitting there in the second row, lady there and gentleman there with an incredibly well-behaved child. There you are. Yeah, my daughter would not be like that. Al,
Al Garthwaite, I'm councillor for Headingley. Hashtag Me Too and hashtag Time's Up have resonated internationally. Sexual harassment and sexism also take place widespread in schools, particularly high schools. They have a very bad effect on our girls and their mental health, and our boys particularly are looking at a lot of porn and getting a totally false view of relationships from that and how girls should be and how they should be. How would you go about tackling this?
Thank you. Two ladies behind.
I think there's a problem at the minute in schools with identifying learning difficulties and the impacts that has on mental health. Since my GCSE years, I've suffered from anxiety and depression, and it wasn't until going to uni a couple of months ago I've actually been diagnosed with dyslexia and dyspraxia, and we're kind of like linking that in now, that might have been the reason that I had all the anxiety during GCSE years and since then. I basically think there should be more of an effort to try and identify learning difficulties.
Yeah. Thanks for that question. Yeah.
Hi, I'm Laura from PSU, and I'd just like to ask, what would your advice be for students like myself who are just really stressed out by the exam pressure brought about through the new A-level and GCSE reforms by the Tory government?
Thank you. Yes, lady here, and then thank you.
I'm Eleanor from East Leeds CLP. My six-year-old son's outstanding inner city school 18 months ago was nevertheless still took over by an academy. And in 1 year, he had three different teachers. One of their focuses now is on kind of SATS tests and results. And I wondered what his position is on SATS tests, especially the year two, seven-year-olds SATS test.
Thank you.
Yeah, it's Andrew. I'm a science teacher in Wakefield. My question is about what the Labour government would do about the performance management structure that teachers have. I've seen many teachers fail and be denied pay progression because they were set unrealistic, unachievable targets by head teachers that then passed their own performance management and gave themselves a £10,000 pay rise.
Thank you very much. Thanks for all of those questions and so much expertise and knowledge in the room, which I'm sure has been incredibly helpful to Angie, over to you.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, I think I've got them all. There were some themes, but I'll try not to go off track and I'll try and keep on to them. Thank you for the recognising my work on animal welfare and what this government has done on animal welfare. Well, they haven't got any welfare. In fact, they haven't got that much welfare that they sent Gold there. He had done enough damage in education, so now he's terrorising our wildlife, quite frankly. I mean, on an absolute serious point, we know that badger culling doesn't work. It actually doesn't work. We know that, and it's a disgrace that practice is still going. And it's costing a lot of money to do it as well, so we know it's not working. It's costing lots of money. I'd just say in terms of, we've just published last week, Sue Hyam, who's our Shadow DEFRA spokesperson. She's just published a whole manifesto on our animals, like giving people the right to have pets. It's also about protecting wildlife, etc. So it's definitely on my newsfeed, and you can get it off Sue's newsfeed as well. She put it all together, and it is really comprehensive, and actually has been welcomed by people in the wildlife sphere. So she's doing a really good job in that regard. But we've got to keep the pressure up. We have got a different plan on how we protect our wildlife, because they have just as much rights in the world as we do. And I was told that how people treat animals generally tends to be a measure of how people are and how nice they are. Rachel, in terms of the curriculum now, there's a few questions around curriculum and how it's narrowed, and it's having a massive impact on young people, because I hinted at it in my speech about how I felt I was failed by the system, because I talk about having a master's in real life. I'm not an academically type person. Sit me in a room, and that part of this job absolutely appalls me when I have to read legislation and stuff. I'd rather not. I have Nick, my staff there, who is punished by having to do all that and then put it into normal speak for me. It really does my head in having to do that. But I can put things into normal speak, and I can develop a picture around things. And you know, we need a curriculum that encompasses all people and allows them to do that. We need a curriculum that's developed by professionals in the field, teachers and professionals that do that. So first of all, one of the things that I'm trying to do is, part of the consultation for the NES is about making sure that every child gets the opportunity to have a broad-based curriculum, first of all, so we don't narrow it. I think e-baccalaureate, which is David's point, is absolutely toxic and has been absolutely toxic to our system. I think the SATs, nobody remembers the SATs. Nobody asks me about my GCSEs. I freely give it that I didn't have any. How many people are going to be asked about, where is your key stage two? But it absolutely destroys people's lives by making them feel failures for it. So we've got to get rid of this testing. And I am looking at the Finland model. I'm looking at the Canadian model as well in regards to that. And which comes to some of the points that I was asked about the head teacher before, and a few people have talked about. I'm working with Jonathan Ashworth, our Shadow Health Secretary. We've got a plan to make our 0-5 the healthiest in the world. That's quite a high bar considering where we are at the moment. But actually, with some key things we can change that. I want to see our schools having occupational therapists, having support, having all of those speech and language therapists, all of those counsellors, and all that right in the school, right there. So they're looking after the whole school. So that point about... young people early who need extra support, because people need support at different times in their lives. It's not one-off thing or one particular type of person. Why are we labelling and stigmatising people for different things? Let's celebrate young people and give them the support when they need it, so they don't have to reach a criteria to get speech and language if they need it. If that's based in the school, then we can look after the school community as a whole, and they'll know the pupils. And other countries do this exceptionally well, which is what we should be doing here, which is what mine and Jonathan's plan is to do. Now, in terms of Ofsted, one of the things which was our friend from, I think it was Putsey constituency, who had asked me about Ofsted, and one of the things that I did actually a couple of weeks ago is I was meeting Amanda, from the chief from Ofsted, and 2 days before I met her, I didn't mean to do it, and my staff are like this, but I basically said Ofsted's not fit for purpose, and it went over I went to go to my office and sort of semi-agreed with me. You know, she meant in terms of apprenticeships and overseeing that, but I felt, in the general rule, it's not good, quite frankly. But this whole business around the competitive testing and targeting. It's so toxic in our system at the moment, and it's not what we need to be. We need to be building young people's resilience so that they can work in the world of work and work in the world that we've got at the moment as well and survive in that world. So instead of this constant narrowing of curriculum, what we want to set up is, I as part of the National Education Service, part of my job is to, I'm probably one of only a very few people to hold the position that don't think I've got a goddamn right to know all the answers to everything. Everybody else generally feels if they've been to school, they have a wealth of experience and that they can change the curriculum on that basis. So, I personally don't think I'm the best place to change the education system in that way. So I want to set up, like in the National Health Service, you wouldn't tell a consultant how to do their job. I want to set up a body of experts that looks at our national curriculum and creates a curriculum that's better for our young people, that equips them for the future and does give them a broad-based curriculum based on what they need rather than what a Secretary of State says they need. So I want to make it more arm's length so that people like me can't meddle in the curriculum when we get into that job. In terms of the issue around maths, I mean, that the Wakefield Academy Trust and what happened there was an absolute scandal. You might as well have just put them on eBay and said our kids are up for sale. You know, it was so, so bad. It was heartbreaking to see what happened. And that's what happens when there's no accountability. You know, the accountability within Multi Academy Trust at the moment sits with the Secretary of State. Well, that's Bobbins. Clearly, it doesn't work. We need that local authority oversight within our school system. We will make sure that's in there. And multi-academy trusts are basically what were LEAs without any geographical footprint. And they dream off and they take money out of the system. And there is fraud, there is problems with the current system. And actually, when there's not enough money going around anyway, it's an absolute scandal what's going on in some of those multi-academy trusts. It's not right. It's not created good school places. The link between whether a school's an academy, a free school or whatever else, the link is not there, actually, about what makes a good school. We know because of the London Challenge, which is a comprehensive system, says actually what you do is you pay teachers appropriately, you allow them to teach in the classrooms, you allow the support staff to be there to support, and you talk about collaboration with our schools, not competition. Make me really upset because, you know, I had a friend whose daughter's 14 and she tried to kill herself with anxiety trying to get into school, and they were pushing her into school and she couldn't do it, and she ended up leaving school because of that, and she rang me for advice, and my advice was to take her out and homeschool her because her child was gonna, you know, had already tried to kill herself once. You can't have that situation, and part of that is because our school system is failing our young people at the moment, and this is what keeps me awake at night, is making sure that we reverse that so we can celebrate and support our young people without them feeling that if they don't do a particular subject or they're not particularly good at one thing, that they end up dropping out or feeling like somehow they're failures in life from one extreme to another. So I'm really sorry that the system has failed your daughter in the way that it has, and I'm absolutely more devastated to tell you that it's going to fail much more before Labour get into power. And you know, and I commend everybody, including our candidate here, who's putting themselves forward, and my local government colleagues here, who at the moment, when it feels like managing the decline, as you heard from Lisa earlier, the work and the priorities they do in trying to stop some of that that's happening at the moment, they're heroes to me. They put up with so much flak. They have a Tory government that is pushing these cuts down onto them, and at the same time they are desperately trying to stop our young people facing the absolute brunt of that. So absolute hats off to those people, those activists, those teachers. Richard, you asked me about the arbitrary caps thing. What I mean by that is, at the moment, our current system says that you can go for an apprenticeship at a certain age, or you can go for higher education, but it's much difficult to get back in because of the fee structure that puts people off as they're older. Or there's these like arbitrary ceilings at particular times when people get the opportunities within our education system for whatever reason. I want to break down those those caps. So, for example, a lot of young people are turning to a particular field in degrees or higher education, or they're even turning to higher education because they're told that that's what they should do, because that will give them a job, instead of actually looking at, if I'm good at arts, which, by the way, our GDP and the amount of money that comes into our economy from arts and culture, it's not just, as some like to say, airy-fairy stuff, it's actually really important to our economy and really important to business that we do. But young people have said, there's lots of miserable lawyers out there, let me tell you. Because they were told to go to law school or do a law degree or do this particular thing, and they're being pushed down a particular track. I want a national education service that values education for what it can do to our society and to the individual, so that actually people don't feel like they're pushed into a narrow set, or that they've got to a particular age and they can't afford it. If you're in your 30s and you've got a family, you're not going to put £9,000 a year on yourself on a potential risk of you self-indulgently wanting to get an education, and you might not be able to get the job that you want at the end of it, and it deters you from doing those things. So we want to create a system that doesn't deter people from doing what actually makes them happy, because we want happy people, because happy people are productive people. So hopefully that's what the system will create, and that's what I meant by the caps on. It's a cap on aspiration, ultimately, and I want to change that. And that talked about also the things I was saying about automation, the rise of automation, and people's work and what they'll do in life. People will change, we're living longer, people's abilities will change throughout life. We're not fixed mindset as the old system used to think. So again, we need an education system that reflects that. And part of the work that we do on the board, the specialisms on the curriculum, will hopefully help expand that to ensure that we can. It's not, John asked from Unite after that, who's a learner rep, it's not actually employers that are going to be doing this work to support our communities and support workers. So we need to enhance union learner reps and give more power and control to them in the workplace to ensure that actually we do help people. But the state is going to have to step in and support employers when people migrate between jobs, because the employers are not going to do it. And I believe that's why we talked about corporation tax paying for the National Education Service, because actually we will provide a service for business and support the economies of the future, which I think is the right way of doing it. And it comes on to John's point about the apprenticeship levy. We wouldn't spend it in the way that the current government is. And I won't be talking about numbers, I'll be talking about quality as well, because if we want true parity of esteem, then actually we've got to make sure that apprenticeships are valuable, that actually mean something to somebody and can get a job or a qualification at the end of it. And at the moment, what's challenging is the new apprenticeships that are coming on board, the level 5 plus. Most of the kids that used to do the apprenticeship route will never get anywhere near to get those. So actually those young people that would have gone the higher education route have now two bites at the cherry. They could do either one. But actually the young people from maybe a working class background, or young people from my type of background, who would have found apprenticeships much more valuable. The level 3, 4 before that, there's a big gap emerging because the cuts in the funding that's happened to allow those students to get onto level 3 and 4, to get them up to those apprenticeships. They'll never get that opportunity now. So there's a big piece of work for us to do, which we're working on, around level 3 and level 4 apprenticeships. And unions are key to that, I believe. I came through the union route, so I would say that I'm pretty biased, but I think they're absolutely key to that. We did a fantastic job when I was a union rep. The girls I worked alongside was all home helps, manual workers, and we were all like the secondary breadwinners. The men went out and earned the proper money, and we were glorified cooks and cleaners, as far as most people thought. Actually, we were keeping people out of hospitals, saving people's lives, but don't let that get in the way of our pay. But, you know, most of us have failed education for whatever reason and was pushed down. We through the trade union movement, created a lifelong learning approach within our work sector, and we trained them up to foundation degree level, and now they were able to go on to nursing degrees, and they were supporting people in their own homes, giving palliative care, giving high quality care. We ended up, instead of them losing the jobs through equal pay, they're now what we call assistant practitioners, and the GP commissioning unit throws money at them because we keep people out of hospital because they're highly trained girls. And some of the girls who I worked alongside, who are on my Facebook still now, they said to me, I never thought I'd get a degree. They went and had the gowns on and everything, and it was such, women in their 50s who never thought that they'd ever be able to achieve anything like that were going to their sons and daughters in their 20s going, look at me. They were absolutely thrilled. It really changed their lives and outlook. So that's what the trade unions can do if we work with them, with employers, to ensure that we boost productivity and give people the skills that they need. Connor's point on the new forms of public ownership and how education fits in. Me and Rebecca Long Bailey and John McDonald have been working together on this with the industrial strategy and the regional banking structure, because actually we really do need to, especially like for example devolution, that could have real opportunities, which links into the apprenticeship point about making sure that actually we've got an education system that works for the local economy as well, because how many of our young people end up having to move away to get the jobs that they want rather than actually building those businesses and those infrastructures around what we've got in their local area. So the regional investment banks, we want to see them working towards attracting industry into areas where traditionally maybe they're considered deindustrialised or cold spots economically. I hate that term, but I'm a cold spot economically in my constituency. I want to see the businesses being attracted to my area, and then the education system being able to deliver for those businesses the type of skills that are required going forward. And a key example of this is Prue and Nantwich with Bentley. If Bentley Motors left Prue and Nantwich, a lot of the skilled jobs in the area would be gone overnight. And yet when I talk to the employers at the Prue and Nantwich site, they say one of the big barriers they've got at the moment is the young people are leaving school with all the top grades, but they have to spend 2 years getting them ready to start the skill training before they bring them into their employment. So that's a risk. So if we can't fulfil the opportunities of those employers in those areas, they will leave. They will go elsewhere and get where students and where those skills are. So we've got to make sure that our state education system delivers for them. And that, again, is about building resilient, functional young people that are confident and are outward looking and ready to face the world and face their training. And at the moment, the school system really doesn't work for that. So we will be creating a system that, and through devolution, allows us a national framework, but also allows us to work with big business and support that as part of our industrial strategy to guarantee that a young person will have a job at the end of an apprenticeship and will have opportunities in their local area. In terms of the stuff, let me see if I missed, right. Me Too, school stuff. Okay, Al, I think it was, you asked me a question on that. One of the things that actually, I don't give Justine Greening lots of credit in lots of ways, but one of the things I will give her credit for, and I think it's one that she got sacked for a couple of reasons, knowing that the government was so bad on their education reforms. I think she had a very difficult job because Theresa May kept pushing it. One of the things that Justine Greening did do is she worked with us to ensure that we had compulsory sex and relationship education in schools. Now the task is to push that further, because I'm concerned there's big lobby groups on this particular issue, but I want to see all young people being able to celebrate who they are and have healthy relationships. And I suppose one of the things we've got to do now is really push to make sure that that's what our compulsory SRE does, PHSE. We've got to make sure that it does give people and celebrate people's opportunity to be the best version of who they are, because we've got 10-year-olds. We talked before, and the head teacher mentioned 6-year-olds with mental health problems now. You know, it's starting really early, and we need to be building young people's resilience, because when they get into adolescence, when they're trying to find who they are and they're challenged about how do they fit in a world of social media, which is so, so toxic for our young people, that, you know, if you were bullied at school like me, you shut your door and you went in your house, and then the bullies, they were outside and you were in your home. There's no safe place for our young people anymore. So we've got to build their resilience about healthy relationships, about confidence, about who they are. Many of our young people don't even have an ounce of that resilience before they get into secondary school. So they haven't even built up a bank of reserves. So our primary school should be focusing, instead of testing them, is building young people's confidence about who they are and how they fit in society, and celebrating them for who they are. So hopefully SRE will play a big role in that, in making sure that we do that. And it is about making sure that boys and girls understand healthy relationships. There's no point in just teaching girls about, you know, respect and about the Me Too hashtag and things. Boys have to understand about healthy relationships as well, and we have to change that culture. And I'm really pleased that things like that have been called out recently, because how many of us, especially women in this room, and to a certain extent men, we've been in a room, we've had someone made a joke and we've just sort of not said anything because it's not worth the hassle. But actually, we've got to start calling that out, because otherwise we're just exampling to our young people that that's okay, and it's not okay. Now I'm up to the last few, I think. Lauren, I think it was Lauren, the student, yeah. The current situation, and with the progress rate and attainment and all that shenanigans, again, most employers don't even know that GCSEs are changing at the moment, let alone what they're doing to pupils and students within that. These reforms that are happening, not only have they been pushed through really quickly, and therefore there's not the time for people to get their heads around them before the next reform have come in, but it's actually quite damaging, because the grades that young people are getting are not being celebrated either, because most people don't really understand what they're about anymore. And in fact, they're also saying that, you know, Labour made it too easy in exams. No, we didn't. No, we didn't. There's nothing about easy exams when we were at school. So what pressure is put on our young students at the moment is overwhelming, and we will change that system when we get in. You know, Jeremy talked about arts curriculum as well. We've put money into that to make sure that those opportunities are there as well, so that people can celebrate and enjoy other aspects to learning rather than the STEM subjects which this government are fixated in. You know, we want to try and make the regime better. I'm working with the National Union of Students. I'm doing a consultation at the moment, and it comes back to some of the other questions. I'm also working with the trade unions about what can we ask teachers not to do, which somebody asked me about, how do we keep teachers, how do we get teachers into the profession. One of the things when I'm talking about change and the pace of change, it's been overwhelming. And if I said I'm going to change the whole system tomorrow, I'd probably lose the half that are left in by doing that. But one of the things that I immediately have tasked the unions to work with me on is saying, what can we stop teachers having to do that they currently do that makes no difference whatsoever to the young people's lives in the classroom? And part of that is around primary assessments and around data gathering, around, you know, all of this stuff that the current government asks you to do. I'm working with your unions and organisations to stop that happening, because that will have a knock-on effect on students as well, and we'll be able to support the pressure that they're under and try and alleviate some of that. Eleanor, and again, three different teachers. I mean, you're lucky if your teacher's qualified in schools now. 60% more unqualified teachers in academies and multi-academy trusts now than there were. So the dumbing down of the teaching profession and what they've done there is absolutely appalling. So first of all, one of the things we said is we'd guarantee there was a qualified teacher in every classroom. And again, like I said before, we're also looking at these SATs and testing regimes and saying, well, what's the value of it? What's it doing? And again, with the gentleman's comments on Finland, the way in which they inspect schools in Finland is different. And I'm looking at different models of inspection. I will hold teachers to account, but I'll pay them and I'll allow them to do their job so that we have confidence in the system. But I will also look at the inspection regime to make sure it's fit for purpose, so it's inspecting the school and not putting pressure on the teachers and the pupils, actually, and saying that if you're not a particular type of pupil that's going to get that particular grade, then somehow the school's failed. No, you know, my son was born at 23 weeks, he's registered blind, he doesn't do very well in his tests, but I tell you what, he survived being born at 23 weeks, he's a miracle baby for me. As long as he's able to walk, talk and enjoy his life as a happy adult, he's passed as far as I'm concerned. So. Goes to parents evening and the teacher is really upset about it, but the teacher has to sit there and tell me how my son's failing and not meeting the required standard. You know, she literally squirms in a chair because she knows that actually he's doing extremely well, he's progressing really well, he's the most happiest child you'll ever meet, but according to this regime that she has to do, my son's underperforming in every level of the current standards that he's supposed to have. So we've got to change that system, actually. I don't want any parent going to a parent's evening and being told that their kid's not at the right standard. It's absolutely disgraceful. And coming back to the final point, which was the science teacher about the performance management system, we want to create a continual personal development system. I'm working with the teacher unions again on how we develop that, because in OECD studies we show that where teachers get to collaborate and where teachers get the opportunity to have ongoing professional development, actually we get better standards of education. Whereas if we drill down and have this current oppressive system that the government introduced, actually it's not creating the results that we want. It's absolutely degrading the teachers that are currently in the system. And as you quite rightly demonstrated in your example, with people that quite frankly shouldn't be in education get rewarded, and other people that see it as a vocation and throw away and do away with and ignore the stuff that they're pushed at the moment to say this is what you should do, and they ignore that and actually concentrate on the young person in front of them, are failed and are pushed through the current performance structures to say that they're not good teachers. Well, I celebrate them as heroes. Anyone that continues in the system currently, despite the constraints on you, I think you're absolute heroes. And I want to release you from that burden and that pen that you're currently in that stops you from being able to do your job. I'll hold you to account, but I'm sure you'll be happy to allow me to do that if I allow you to do your job. So hopefully... There is a huge amount of work that we need to do. We are consulting on the draft charter at the moment, and hopefully Rachel will do a session with you and Alex will as well about how we take that forward. We've got an NPF, a National Policy Forum today, which will hopefully give it the green light so that we can go forward with that charter. And I want your ideas as part of that on how we can find the solutions to these things. I know you have the solutions. I don't have all the solutions, but I know you do, and I'm confident that by working with you, actually, we'll get an absolute blueprint for when I get the opportunity to be your education secretary. I can, from day one, hit the ground running and start implementing some of these things with your help rather than against you. So thank you very much.
Children are in safe hands when Angela is our Secretary of State for Education. So thank you, Angela.
I'm the MP for Leeds North. It's written Leeds North. It's great to have Rachel and Leeds West here. And thank you to Kate for organising it. I'm just going to say a couple of things. First of all, that it's great, Angela. I met Ange for the first time 5 years ago at Fabian Conference. We went for coffee at UCL because we come from the north and had to get up really early, so we needed a coffee, didn't we? And Ange is just, then she came across as somebody who was so passionate, so articulate, somebody that really got where we needed to be going, and that's so true. You know, now she's become an MP, now she's Shadow Secretary of State Education, see that up close. I've seen her take on the Tories, particularly around higher education. She ran rings around the Tories on our higher education debates around fees. The Tories put up straw man arguments about why we shouldn't have free higher education, about why they were charging 6.1% on student loans. Absolute straw man arguments, which Angela absolutely tore apart. And I cannot wait to see Angela Rayner be the Secretary of State for Education in this country. She will revolutionise our education system from the cradle right through life for everybody in this country. So it's amazing that she's here today, not doing just one event here, but also coming to have some cake and do another event with me, she's looking forward to the cake, in St. Chad's in Wheatwood. The only other thing I want to say is we don't know when general election is going to be, when Angela's going to become Secretary of Education, but we do know in 2.5 months, the largest election in the UK is going to be here in Leeds. We're going to elect 99 councillors. Nowhere else in the UK is going to elect 99 councillors, just us in Leeds. The eyes of the media we're watching Leeds, the performance of Jeremy Corbyn, the performance of us here in Leeds. If we don't do well in Leeds, the media will say the Labour Party's failing, the Labour Party's not popular, because we are going to be electing 99 councillors. We've got places in Leeds that do not have Labour councillors that should have Labour councillors. I live in Weetwood Ward. We have three Liberal Democrat councillors. Unfortunately, none of our candidates are here because they're all making cake and making tea and some chat. We've got three great candidates, James, Christine and John. We've got the three all Indian councillors in who are the other three Lib Dems. We should not be having Lib Dems in Leeds North West anymore. I can see Elliot and Sian, and I'll come to that, and James who are here. We've got a lot of councillors that are here that are up for re-election. Obviously, Lisa and Jules, I can see, and the three Headingley councillors. And when I lived in Headingley, there were no Labour councillors. It was Lib Dems. So now we've got three Headingley councillors. So we need a whole Headingley. And then we've got Hannah, obviously, in Kirkstall. We've got family where the councillors here.
Matt's here.
Andy not here. No. Anyway, but we've got family where we've got no Labour councillors. We should have three Labour councillors, three Greens. The Greens are not the progressive party, we are the progressive party. You know, and we've got other places, Morley South, where there's one Labour council and two not Labour councillors. We've got Horsforth, we've got Calverley and Farsley. We can gain double figure number of councils in Leeds. And the media cannot say the Labour Party's failing. The media will come to Leeds and say, look what the Labour Party's doing, the Labour Party on the road to government. And that's down to us. We're wearing that. So get out in your own wards, but also come to the wards where there aren't Labour councillors, where we can win those council seats. It's vitally important. Last year, I was only elected because people came from all over the city to work here in Leeds North West to register students and to get them out to vote. And in all of those wards, there's work to do on voter registration, getting people out to vote. So come, help, get involved, and let us see tens, dozens of new Labour councillors come May. Thank you.
And introduce Hannah Biddle, our candidate in Kirkstall, who's going to speak about a day in the life of being a teacher under a Conservative government.
And
thank
draw
you.
The raffle.
And draw the raffle.
Well, good afternoon, folks. As has been said, my name's Hannah Biddle, and I am one of the Labour candidates in Kirkstall for the local elections taking place this May. I'm currently working as a teacher in Bradford and have done for 5 years. During this time, I've been privy to the gradual dismantling of the education system by the Tory government. I'd like to describe to you a day in the life of a teacher, and through this, we'll investigate some of the many ways that Tory cuts have debilitated our education system. Teachers are paid for 1,265 hours a year. Over the 39 weeks that we teach, it works out as 6.5 hours of pay a day. Of course, the averaging doesn't take into consideration parents' evenings and all the other things that we have to do outside of regular school hours. So let's suggest it's 6 hours a day to make up for that wide variety of things that we do. So personally, I leave for school at 6:45, sometimes 5:15 if I'm feeling really enthusiastic and want to get in a sneaky gym session, but obviously that's not all that often. I get into work around 7:15 and I walk swiftly to the photocopy room. Now at this point, I'm feeling really smug because I photocopied last night. If I didn't photocopy last night, it takes about 20 minutes for the photocopier to turn on. And then you've got around a 1 in 3 chance that it'll be broken anyway. I have mentioned a few times that perhaps it would be worth getting a new one. But as we've heard several times already today, there just isn't the money. So I wander back to my classroom. And actually, my classroom's beautiful. Nice new purple walls. We've just got our academy sorted in the last sort of 12 months, and now we've got a new CEO. So suddenly, £750,000 has fallen out of the sky for new chairs and paint. Still the same photocopier, though. I use the rest of my time in the morning marking books, lesson planning, and doing otherly teacherly things. My favourite is to go into somebody else's classroom, print screen their desktop, put it on a PowerPoint loop, so when they click, it looks like their computer's broken. You're all welcome. But mainly, of course, the important stuff. So 8:15 comes round, and I walk up for my last wee before the day begins. Anyone that works in schools, and I know we've got a lot of teachers here, knows the importance of a teacher bladder. So you can hold for long periods, and more importantly, the exact timing of the urination to allow for optimum urination to teacher task ratios. But wait, I arrive at the toilets and yeah, they're locked. So I've asked a few times again, I do a lot of asking, for a key to the toilets, the staff toilets, but there isn't the money to get loads of these cut while we're still doing the renovations. So for now, I'll just have to hold. 8:20, the students arrive. It's at this point that the real cuts come to light. We have to check their uniform and make sure it's being worn appropriately. Now, this uniform costs around £115 when bought vastly from places like Tesco. It could end up costing a lot more, especially if your child doesn't fit those media-defined sizes, so you have to get adult shirts or extra-long trousers. Every week now, kids are not in uniform, and we always have the same notes being provided. Trixie unfortunately can't wear school shoes today because they broke yesterday and I have to wait till payday to get her some new ones. These are the working poor that this Tory government is consistently penalising and consistently making their lives increasingly difficult. Schools at the moment are even having to provide cleaning facilities so we can wash the clothes of students whose parents can't afford to wash them at home. I'm going to repeat that. We have to wash the children's clothes as working parents are unable to do so at home. We also have to check equipment. The students must have a ruler, a pen and a pencil. I've had a few students that have never got these items. I've given them detention, I've written notes in their planner, I've spoken to them at length, and they just can't bring it in. Now I'm not willing, and nor are a lot of my colleagues, to let these students consistently be singled out in every lesson for not having the correct equipment. So I provide a ruler, I'll provide a pen, I'll provide a pencil. Obviously not from the school budget, as there isn't any of that, but from my own pocket. And realistically, as teachers, we're not talking millions here, but we are talking a couple of quid from each teacher each week. Now, during form time once a week, I get to teach the students how to be good people, how to recognise inappropriate relationships, how to keep themselves safe, how to feel confident in their own skin, how to not be racist, homophobic, and generally discriminatory to others. This used to be an hour a week, and now it's one 20-minute slot, during which we have to do registers, union check, uniform checks, etc. PSHCE is my favourite thing to teach, and I've previously held teaching and learning responsibility in that area. But generally, staff don't receive any training on how to develop students in this area, so we're very much on our own, smashing it out at a rate of knots, meaning these core life messages are being delivered in an ad hoc manner by good luck rather than good management. Indeed, because there's so much pressure on other parts of the school day, there isn't even a cohesive plan. For example, there was nothing organised to celebrate the 100 years of partial suffrage that occurred the other week. Of course, I discussed it and put together an assembly because, let's face it, I never turned down an opportunity for a feminist rant to people that aren't allowed to leave. But realistically, it should never have fallen to me. So now, it's time to move on to lessons. We have a bunch of students in front of us, and many of them don't have pens, especially in lower sets where there's more pupil premium kids. A coincidence? I think probably not. After I've given out the few pens I have on my desk, I still haven't got enough for the students that have not got one. So I look in my new favourite location. I look under my desk, just to the side of the left leg, and locate the inner from a biro. Now it must be black. I can't give them a pencil, because that would be me not doing my job properly. So I have this one inner that I can give to a student, and who knows exactly where the outer is, what it's become. The inner is there, so because we've cut the number of cleaners and given them more and more to do, less and less time in each classroom. Things, they're going to get missed. The cleaners now have to literally, and I do mean this literally, repaint the walls of the corridor once a week. No wonder I find the odd pen in her. Today, however, it's my saving grace. In a few short seconds, I can take apart a purple pen and put in the black inner so the students all have writing implements and we can begin. And you know what? This is the dream. This is what teaching's made of. Discussion with students, then working through questions and answers, arms going up with enthusiasm and excitement over the topic they're learning about. And then a student, they ask you, if a ladybird spider happened because of a ladybird and a spider getting it on. Shoulders drop as you explain that can't possibly be the case. Location, size, genus. And of course, you cite the spider monkey as evidence. The student was studying the intricacies of ecosystems in year 10. By this point, I'm getting to the end of a cup of tea and wondering once again why we don't have enough toilet keys in school. So, it's year 11 time, and during this Tory government, they've betrayed the students in this country in a way that's unacceptable. They've set them up to fail in the new GCSE system. By switching it over to numbered grades and confusing the students, this year's year 11 are feeling broken. Teachers are making their best guesses, and we're all waiting for this year to be over in the hope that our kids magically come out on top. I'm on a variety of Facebook groups for a variety of exam boards, and everyone is in the same boat. Most haven't even finished the course content, and realistically, they're not looking likely to before the exam. How is this level of stress on students appropriate for safeguarding our young people? So the GCSE lessons plod on, and we pray to a number of deities for success. And now break time. It's time for a wee, I hear you say. Not yet. Playground duty. So I have to stand out in the cold and watch students whose parents can't afford to send them in a coat, shivering. This is not one specific school, but most. We can't staff enough space indoors to keep the kids in the warm because there's no money to pay break and lunch supervisors. It's disgusting that in the north of England, people who are in work are forced to have this type of poverty affect their children. Under this Tory government, the situation for these working families with children in poverty is just getting worse. We need a Labour government to create a U-turn. So now break's over, and I have to teach a bottom set lesson. I have some of the most kind-hearted and lovely students in this lesson, but my goodness, is it hard. Trying to get these kids to copy the date off the board is often a real challenge. It's a mix of special needs students and those that are yet to learn English. Normally, I would have had at least two teaching assistants in this lesson, one specialising in the statement in child's needs, and one who specialises in English as an additional language, often somebody that themselves has English as an additional language. I currently, for the most part, have none, not least because they've left for a pay rise in Tesco. I'm currently advertising for more of them, but the job is so hard, and there's so little money being paid to them, that really I can't blame people for not falling over themselves to take it. Teaching and working in schools is hard enough. To do it and still not be able to afford to heat your own home is unacceptable and undervaluing. At the beginning of lunchtime, a student arrives at my classroom door, visibly upset. I usher them in, and they tell me a harrowing story about how much their life outside of school sucks. I promise them that I will pass it on, and we will sort out some sort of help from somewhere. I make this promise because the school will help them in some way. Will it be the most effective way? No. We haven't got enough money for mental health provision in schools, youth workers' hours are being cut right back, and we don't have a school nurse, just an admin assistant who happens to be a first aider. I usher them out with at least 15 minutes to go of lunch so they can get food, as realistically it could be the only meal that they're able to get today, and I desperately don't want them to miss it talking to me. Of course, I fill in all the necessary documentation at lunchtime, having listened to all they have to say, and made sure that they know they can come back and see me whenever they need. Then lunch is over and I've missed another meal. Clearly, I'm not suggesting this happens every day, but on average, once a week, I work through my unpaid lunchtime. Now it's 1:15, lunch is over, and so is my 6 hours pay for the day. From now on, I work for free. But I do get a free period now, during which I need to write a report on the intervention I've done for year 11. So I have to plan the intervention, run the intervention, evaluate the intervention, chase those that didn't come to the intervention, email parents about the intervention, mark the intervention work, and then finally, I need to let everyone know about the intervention, just to prove I'm actually doing my job. And now, as we reach the end of the day, drum roll please, I make it across to a toilet. I head back to my classroom and sit down to work. On a day like this, it would usually be accompanied by power ballads or Shania Twain, something uplifting, and I'd be doing more marking, planning and resourcing. At about 5:45, I'll leave for home, and realistically, a takeout so you can face cooking after a day like that. So as interesting as I hope you found my trip down memory lane, it's bigger than me, bigger than us, and it's bigger than schools. Austerity policy from this Tory government is literally ploughing families all over the country into poverty. 500,000 children are showing up to school having not had breakfast. They're forced to go hungry and it impacts their ability to concentrate and to manage their behaviour. This means they're more likely to be sent out of class, with missing learning time, they're more likely to miss whole days due to exclusion. All of this affects their attendance, and it has been proven that their GCSE grades, on average, drop with 5% that they miss of their school time. This means they're less likely to be successful long term, and they're more likely to become stuck in that poverty trap. Furthermore, period poverty impacts girls in Leeds and across the country. It's hard to comprehend, but girls are having to stay off school, missing up to 15% of their education because they can't afford sanitary protection. These working poor students are less likely to be able to access field trips, as parents can't pay and schools just can't subsidise anymore. We have to charge other parents to cover the cost of the bus, so we don't use the budget that we have for lessons. In subjects like geography, which is what I teach, this means that they lose out automatically on 15% of their GCSE marks because the fieldwork is compulsory. And again, that hits their chances of using education as a way out of the poverty trap. Schools have stopped being able to use this, stopped being able to be the safety net that they once were for our most vulnerable students. The Tory policy of not offering early childhood services leads to less access to early education, so from the very dawn of their life, they are unable to have the same good start as those of you that were born under a Labour government. Again, it doesn't stop once school itself is over. Higher education is now prohibitively expensive. Children are actually saying in their careers meetings with our careers advisor that they can't carry on education as it's too expensive and they need to get a job to help support their families. How have the Tories delivered us back into the Victorian era and allowed this generation of children to work their grindstone? Young people, even when they leave education, are being thrown into thousands of pounds worth of debt and an unreliable job market with internships providing companies with free labour. 0-hour contracts and wages that don't provide enough to live. There's only one solution, and you've come to the right place. It has to be to re-elect a Labour government. Yay. A Labour government. A Labour government will once again make sure our students have the chance to be happy, healthy and thrive. Students under a Labour government will be well educated, able to flourish in the labour market, enjoy school and all the wonderful opportunities that it can offer. And teachers, we beg of only one thing, to let us teach.
Thank you for that insight into the Teachers' Day. My parents are teachers, so I'm sure to ask them about the teacher's blood when I next see them.
Teaching assistants get it too.
I think it just shows to demonstrate how much we need Hannah on Leeds City Council and her experience there, and also how much we need a Labour government to help Leeds City Council to deliver the things we need to. We're now going to move on to the raffle, because no Labour Party event is complete without the raffle.
It's a quiet one.
Hannah going to announce the...